Let's go on to item number two, which is the time-sensitive change order.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move up item 19 after Ken's two.
Two, two.
And we have some folks here that.
You want to move 19?
After your Ken's two.
Number four.
After the new two.
Or the two and the three together.
Yeah. Not just three. Not just three. After the number four.
Okay.
Wait a minute. I think you moved two, moved seven up after number two.
Wait a minute, you got two, two. We got two A and two B.
And two.
The new two, you're going to move down three.
Yeah.
Or how one number.
We have a motion.
Move number 19 up after Ken's.
We have a motion, we have a second. There's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes unanimously. Yes, sir. Change order for South.
Yeah, someone asked, there you go. Yes, go ahead, Don.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is a request for some design change order for the South Parks. Briefly, it's at Old Atlanta to brick in the little pump building that's there. And then at the Chattahoochee Point Park is to add water lines and electrical to the park. It had been a primitive park and that was not going to be a service, and they've asked to add this to it, including hand washing stations and fountain, water fountains. And then also at Caney Creek Preserve, Hawk Creek Park, and Old Atlanta Park to take water to the pavilions and to bring in water fountains and bring electrical with lighting at the pavilions and the restroom buildings. The total design cost to add these would be $17,000.
$17,000?
For the design work, yes, sir.
Just for the design work?
That's for the design work. But we have a contract with Hayes James for the design. It is for all four parks, for all these, all the plans have to be modified and shown.
That's for all four parks?
That's all four parks, yes, sir. The Chattahoochee Point Park is a little bit more work.
Pretend I don't know what a hand washing station is.
It's basically a place where there's water that comes up, you can wash your hands, it's not a sink, then you're going to have a gravel disposal, you have to have a.
This is in the restroom or?
It's on the outside of the restroom for the hand washing station. And and also with your water fountains, at these, some of these locations at the water fountains, they also have to have the gravel pit underneath designed so that the water, wastewater can be disposed of appropriately.
What? Brian's asking me or saying that they need lights in the restroom. I absolutely agree with that. I'm not sure why we need hand washing stations.
That was a request that was made.
But there's water going to be down there anyway. I mean, the hand washing stations are essential.
What?
You can take it off backwards if you want to. You don't want it better. You don't want to wash your hands.
Outside the restroom, I think.
At Chattahoochee Point. At the other stations, at the other parks, at Caney Creek, Hawk Creek, and Old Atlanta, that's actually bringing the water to the pavilions, so they have water at the pavilions and water fountains. Yes, sir?
Could you sit right here, please?
Yes, sir.
I can't.
Can't hear.
Hey, Todd.
Yes.
We're getting a lot of background noise, so it's difficult to hear the presenter. Is there any way you can minimize that?
It's minimized.
Okay, thank you.
I can't listen to you. Thank you.
Okay.
Are you done?
Yes, she is.
Yes, unless you had any other questions.
I make a motion when we add the change order. Do you need authorities to sign that?
Yes.
That's my motion. $17,000.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying.
Make that time sensitive.
Hold it time sensitive. If somebody's got to wash their hands that quick.
They're down there waiting right now. Change the diaper.
Time sensitive basis, okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Okay, now are we at the date fund or are we at the year change?
No,
item seven, unless you get item seven.
Item seven.
Oh, I thought all that's not here.
No.
Okay.
You can't.
Come on down here.
So you don't get all.
Why can't you wash your hands at the spray park?
You can't, you just have to do the other parks to go do.
Why can't, hand washing things be in spray parks, huh?
Commissioner Chairman, Commissioners, we're here today to request approval of the proposed operating hours and fees at the Cold Atlanta Spray Pad, and it was recommended by Parks and Rec Board.
Yes, I'm set.
What was recommended by?
What's the hour?
On Monday, it's closed for maintenance and private rentals. Tuesday and Saturdays, it'll be open from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. Tuesday through Saturday. Sundays, 1 p.m. to 6 p.m.
We have to have a, I guess, someone to stand by all time. I mean, we'll have personnel down there during these hours.
Yeah, we'll have personnel. We'll be charging a daily admission. And so we'll have staff, probably two to three staff down there.
We'll take a daily admission. We'll offset our expenses if we come close.
It'll be closed, but we'll be on Mondays. We'll be having private rentals and stuff. We talked to Roswell, some of the other counties that have them and cities, and they do well with the private rentals and parties.
What month are these closed?
We'll be closing probably Labor Day weekend, I agree. This year, not sure about opening, but we'll probably open early spring.
So it's just for those few months?
Yeah.
I'll make a motion.
Excuse me a second. You want to talk about the fees at all? It's part of this, it's part of this item as well, for the hours and the fees.
Yeah.
What do you, what's your cost?
Oh, the fees for, yeah, that you're going to charge.
Yeah, what's the cost of the event? Take care of.
Well, our daily admission fee is, what we're looking at is $2. We talked about Roswell, they charge $1. So I know, Jim, if the fee, what?
We're looking at, with staff and operations, the cost of operating the spray pad at about $2,000. That's going to be about $2,000 a week. So we're looking at about 40 visitors, basically, per day, would cover our costs. And I think that in those hot summer days, we'll get more than 40 visitors a day.
What's the cost per person?
$2. The adults will be free if they're bringing it in a paying child, but they'll be on the dry deck. They'll not be in the water park. We'll be also selling annual passes, individual pass for $30 a year, family pass for $50. Private rentals, going to be 2-hour rentals for $200 and a maximum of 100 participants. And we'll also have a pavilion there beside it, and it'll be $100 for 2 hours, and $50 in each additional hour for the pavilion there.
100 participants max.
A rental, and we'll be able to do, it'll be 2-hour blocks for the rentals.
Okay.
Yeah.
Motion.
So moved.
Is that time sensitive?
Yes.
Time sensitive.
Second. Time sensitive.
We have a motion and a second to approve this item on a time sensitive basis. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously.
Thank you.
And now, item 19.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item 19 is actually comes to you as a postponement by rule pursuant to the Board of Commissioners rules. This was a matter that was taken up at our last work session involving a Castile subdivision, which is a matter that was in receivership. The Board of Commissioners, as you know, changed its rules with respect to soil and sedimentation fine mitigation to allow our policy to apply not only to bankruptcies or foreclosures, but also to pure receiverships. They had come to you seeking modification with respect to about $62,000 worth of fines on three lots, which were lots 17, 34, and 36. And in your agenda packet, you will see what the amount of fines were. On the board's meeting on May 8th of 2012, there was a motion by Commissioners Bell and a second by Commissioner Boff to reduce the fines by 50% or $31,250, and that no COs issue until the fines are paid. Per our rule, the tie can be broken today, and the clerk needs to record the votes as that motion having been made, with Commissioner Bell and Commissioner Boff voting in favor of the 50% reduction to $31,250 with no COs to be issued, with Commissioners Levant and Amos voting against. And at that point, Commissioner Tam, it'll be your time to vote.
Can I just interject something, please?
It's open. As far as procedurally, there is a motion and second on the table with discussion.
Were the calculations originally made correctly? I'm under the impression when I went back and looked at it that we have to kind of look at the amounts again anyway because they were not made correctly.
The amounts were made correctly. You did not go as low as the policy allows.
But they were made blanket in three lots.
Yes.
And I think that could be made per lot.
Well, there's nothing in the policy that requires to be per lot, but you are more than, you know, you could do anything. You could apportion it per lot.
I think the policy addresses it per lot. I mean, I'm not, I just want to make sure we get it right.
What's per stop work?
Same amount.
What is it? That's
per,
what it's been applied.
Per stop work order.
Well, I've got the policy right here.
And per stop work order?
No, I think, quite frankly, it's per development. I mean, that's what we're looking at, is the development. This one just happens to implicate three lots. You all went down to 30,000. You could have gone as low as 15.
Hold on, let me say this. The reason I voted for that was because I was hung up on the word receivership. I understand now, at least it's my opinion, that receivership is functionally the same thing for our purposes as if it was taken over by the bank.
And it's not functionally the same thing, but from a public policy standpoint, to the extent you're trying to get these developments off the ground, it is the same.
Yes, and so if I look at it that way, I would, now that if I have a chance to vote on it again, I will vote in order to approve the whole amount. So vote against, I would suggest maybe you should vote against it and then re-vote on the whole thing, if you want them to be granted the whole amount.
The whole amount, meaning the whole amount of leniency?
The whole amount of potential reduction that the board can authorize.
Vote against.
Domino.
What's that?
Nay.
Okay, so the...
I mean, I'm for them getting...
You have cast your vote on the tie to vote against the award.
Yes.
That's correct.
All right, so now the motion, the table is clear, if you will, and you may make another motion.
I make a motion we go by our ordinance allowing the 25% reduction. Maximum. What's the maximum reduction?
Maximum reduction is 25% of the accrued fines, which in this case would lower the amount to $15,625.
Total. So, second. Wait, now, for discussion. Are we still up paying it before they get the COs, or are we going to let them get the COs?
Barring any direction otherwise, it would be the same language in the previous motion that they have to pay prior to release of COs.
Can I ask the question of the
receiver?
The bank here. Is the bank here?
Quickly? The receiver has discretionary funds with the fine being as low as $15,625.
So you take care of before closing?
Yes, the larger amount was trouble, was going to be trouble.
Okay. And Commissioner Amos, the maker of the motion, I would request that the county manager be given authority to sign all documents necessary to protect this.
So moved.
Time sensitive.
Time sensitive.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, like sign, that passes unanimously. And we are back on page one, I believe. Item three.
Two.
Yes.
Two.
Chairman, Commissioner, I'd like to take this item. John Shoulders had to leave, court administrator. This is simply a DATE fund. It's a drug abuse treatment education fund. Annual report that's required.
And what you have in front of you on the back of the agenda request is the 2011 annual report. Of course, on there you see the board members and the way, generally, in general, the way the funds were expended. And then you've got a list of where those funds were expended and that the number of participants were 56 and the graduates from the program were 29. I'm not sure that Ms. Childers had anything else to add to that. It's simply a requirement to submit this report to the board.
You need to vote on it?
I don't think you need to vote on that.
Okay.
Just submission of
you said no vote? All right.
Okay.
So I think it's just submission of the report.
Okay.
Kevin, if I may real quick before we go to the next item, I need to make an announcement to take something off the table. I can do that at any time in between items, right?
You may take some, you may make an announcement to take it off the table. Yes. You need to go to the next meeting.
That's right. Think.
Yes, sir.
I want to make an announcement that I'm going to take off the table at the next meeting an issue relating to Larry Pierce and a easement. Originally, on the February 7th, 2008 meeting, and it's a request by Larry Pierce regarding the denial of a variance, VA number 070074.
That just gets added to the next work session.
Okay. Now item three, I believe.
Yes, commissioners, this is a request for the appointment of the employee's representative for the Forsyth County Board of Ethics. Nominations were accepted from all full-time employees through May 4th. Two nominations were tendered. One nomination accepted and another nominee declined. The incumbent, Dr. Rickettson, had chosen not to renew his term. That resulted in a single candidate being nominated as the employee representative. As such, the employee vote for a single nominee did not occur, and they're declared the winner. Therefore, the full-time employees are requesting that the Board of Commissioners appoint Mr. Charles Laughinghouse as a nominee for the position for the employee representative for a two-year term that would begin July 1st, 2012 and run through June 30th, 2014.
Pat, when was the announcement made to the employees?
It was announced, I believe, you mean for the nominees?
Right. Wasn't it April 27th that went out to the employees?
That sounds about right. I don't know the exact date.
And they were taken through May 4th.
Yes.
Which was 7 days. But according to the Ethics Code, Section 2.11.12a, Kenneth can check me on this, that the employees are supposed to be given 30 days to submit nominations. And they were only given 7. So I'm going to make a motion and send this back to the employees.
Let me check that.
Do you say who the other person was? Are you allowed to say that out loud?
I don't actually remember.
Oh, okay.
I don't.
And for what reason?
He chose not to.
No, but you said there were two people.
No, one chose not to do it.
One chose not to do it.
Yeah, he didn't accept the
nomination. But the ethics ruling says that they have 30 days, which then the county manager is supposed to notify the Board of Commissioners within 5 days. And then, in all reality, it then goes to the next regular meeting of the Board of Commissioners, not a work session.
Well, then we better follow the ordinance.
So we need to follow the ordinance. So therefore, I make a motion that we send it back to the employees to reopen nominations for an additional 23 days.
Let's just wait for him to verify.
So is it the case that the appointment or the nomination process was not open for 30 days?
Seven.
It was open for 1 week, for about 7 days.
It was opened on the 27th and closed on the 4th.
I believe it was. She has gone the Tuesday.
Well, I mean, Section 2, 1112A does say that the body or individuals notified shall have 30 days in which to conduct their appointment process and provide the county manager with the name of their appointment.
Does that also hold true for all nominees?
Well, what it says, that has to do with the initial appointment process. But then it says in B that all appointments following the expiration of the initial term
shall
proceed as set forth in Section A, which is the initial process. So it would seem to wrap back up into it again. So it would appear that a 30-day open nomination process appears to be accurate.
The last thing we want to do is not follow that.
I agree.
Would
we need to start over, just scrap it and reopen them for 30 days?
Would the 30 days start from the beginning, or do you use that first week?
Well, if we're going to start the process over again, it would probably make sense just to start it, yeah.
Okay.
For both the elected officials and the employees, then, because they were both already open.
And that, for the record, is the item for the elected officials and the employee representative. And then, okay.
Ken, do you have anything further to add to that?
Mm-hmm. That appears accurate, Mr. Chairman.
So then they need to do that, and then they have to notify the Board of Commissioners within 5 days of who has been elected.
Yeah, and I will tell you, I'm not concerned about it being in a regular meeting, because anything we do here has to go to the regular meeting to be approved anyway. So I don't mind the nominees being discussed here, but it's going to have to be approved.
It has to be approved at regular.
That's correct.
But it doesn't have to come to a work session.
It doesn't have to. It just says that the board shall.
It can go directly to a regular meeting.
That's correct. Regular meeting. Might as well go ahead and put it on regular meeting.
Okay. Do we need a vote or anything?
I don't know. Is that a motion or?
For the record, I would prefer just a motion to basically reinstitute the process.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we not accept the employee representative, Charlie Rackinghouse, or the elected representative, elected officials representative, elections, nominations not open long enough, and then we send it back to the ethics board to start the process.
Let me ask you this question. Would it be appropriate, though, given that those nominations did occur during what was believed to be that they'd be put back into the pool?
I think whoever nominated them can just put them back in again. I would think that we have to conduct it accordingly. It has to be over 30 days.
I don't know why we necessarily have to start the entire cycle over. The 30 days is still running, is it not?
Well, no, I'm comfortable with starting the process over again.
I think we'll start the process over
again.
Then I agree.
Yeah. So they can renominate the people.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ben absent. For items 3 and 4 together, and now we're on to number 5.
Commissioners, this is a request for the approval of stop loss coverage for the inmate medical plan be provided by Lloyd's of London for a period of commencing June 1st, 2012 through May 31st, 2013. This is a time sensitive item, and we currently, for the past several years, have had the stop loss coverage with Hunt Insurance. We had were able to get a second quote from Lloyd's of London, and for the same coverage of a $40,000 deductible with $250,000 per inmate limit per annum. The London came in at approximately $51,532, which is $7,600 less than my insurance. Apples to apples. And we are asking that the county manager be approved to sign the final legal agreements once legal has had a chance to review these to ensure that there's no make or break it, as they call it, verbiage in the agreement.
Okay. Do we hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve the request to stop loss insurance coverage for the inmate medical plan to be provided by Boyd's Plan. Excuse me, from 6-1-2012 to 5-31-2013. With the deductible and fees as noted, and approve the county manager to sign from legal.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further motion, please vote. All those in favor signify. If there's no further discussion, please vote. Please signify by saying aye. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
That all those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levent being absent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Six.
All the changes that we discussed in previous settings, and so we're just here to review the changes that we suggested before moving forward with this. There was some verbiage taken out in fee set and structure that we discussed last time. Some of the verbiage that was removed was the original ordinance required that the waste hauler pass to be on to the customer. And those were taken out because how they did it, they don't have to pass it on or can pass however much they want to. So that kind of changed quite a bit of the verbiage in looking at ordinance, but nothing has been changed necessarily that we didn't, that was not discussed here.
Recycling is optional. They get a reduction off of the franchise fee.
Give it off.
There was a little bit of verbiage put in there requiring that when they place things by the curb, that they make sure that the customer knows not to put it in such way to go in storm drains and such.
So just compared to other counties, Jordan County's solid waste plan?
Ours is actually pretty lax, but at the same time, we've never had an ordinance before. So I think starting
good start.
With this, because to go full-blown would be just...
In our fee structure, you can go down to 1.5%.
And we're not really mandating. It's pretty typical for counties that do not haul their own waste to have some sort of fee, some type sort of franchise for their services. I don't know really of one that doesn't, unless they haul their own waste.
Okay, so if we can review my benefit, please.
Yes.
We're proposing here a 3% increase, or 3%. 5%.
No.
Just a 5% fee.
Yeah.
Franchise fee.
5%. We're calling it an infrastructure fee. Because we're not really putting anything out for bid. It's simply, if you want to haul waste in the county, then you have to adhere to this contract. And it's a 5% fee. You can find that
on page 9.
Yeah.
On page 9.
Yes.
Yes. And then you get a one
actually get 2% discount.
2% discount if you are seated in the county and qualify as a county business, pay county taxes, applicable and such.
Now, that 5% would then go to a 3% total.
Okay. Right, 2% reduction for a 3% fee.
Yes.
So it can also go lower.
Yes.
And then you get a 0.5% reduction if you take the waste you collect in the county to Eagle Point landfill. And you get an additional 1% if you offer recycling.
Would it be easier to take that height down to 1? Would it be easier to calculate on like down to 1% just if I met 1 high?
It would be. The issue there is then you have just almost a monopoly of a couple of companies who are not paying anything, who actually end up being our biggest companies.
You don't mind it being 0.5%?
You don't mind for calculation wise?
It's just a number.
What worries me, and it's just from talking to other, it is we don't want to create a situation where there is some sort of monopoly, because the whole idea behind this is to still have an open market system. And so
just to capture funds from companies that are not headquartered here, that come in, collect waste, they don't take it to another landfill, and got those heavy trucks beating up our roads.
Well, ultimately, whether they take it to our landfill or not, that for me, we're going to eventually get out of the fee. It's just going to be spread out over a long time.
They could take it out of the account, too. They could pull the account or something.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, I don't think 100% is going to change that, because that particular company is usually based out of a landfill. So they're going to pay that fee regardless.
But that kind of makes up for the host fee that we're not getting, that helps offset the infrastructure cost.
And we're filling up our landfill quicker.
And they go on about their business, and we're done. Get those trucks off the road altogether. I think that's
good. But this, to me, this seems high somehow.
What, 5%?
Yeah, starting at 5%. Has anybody, have any, you think that there are 3 or 4 or 5 haulers who have heard about this and have had a chance to react, talk to you about it at all?
I know at least 4 have, because I've gotten letters and references.
What do they say?
To it. A couple of the smaller haulers had questions. I think at the most of it is simply because they haven't gotten facts at this point, because it was just hearsay what was in the newspaper.
But this is this is a minimum of a 1.5% increase for everybody, right?
Yeah, there was some talk about some of the smaller haulers that, what do you call it, go behind the house, what do they call it?
Drive pickup, curbside.
Back door.
That they were going to be harmed, and then somebody started rumoring there was going to be land or recycling center. So none of that's
still
have a horse park that's telling everybody to be a land.
But what are we using the 1.5% for?
Infrastructure. It's actually, the whole idea behind this is to pay for, essentially, we have these companies coming in hauling waste and really benefiting from a service that a lot of counties provide themselves. So they're coming in and
Now remember, even in-county people are paying them.
Right.
So everybody is paying a minimum of the 1.5%. And where's the 1.5% going?
It's going to maintenance and infrastructure fee, which would be engineering, assumably. It's spelled out in here. Let's see, fees paid.
Where I'm going with this is, I could maybe see this if it was going into the roads, because, trucks in general tear things up and they're going all the way to Eagle Point. But the county's getting a buck per ton on the waste anyway. We're sort of giving the locals a little bit of an advantage over ones that are out of the county. I just don't know why. What the 1.5% is really getting the county.
it is going into the roads, because when I say infrastructure, that's what is spelled out in here, is it's going to road maintenance, it's going to solid waste. What page are you coming down on?
It's on page 3, I think. And there are
it's three. Actually spelled out in two places.
How much do you expect to bring in for any calculations?
I really have no clue at this point, because that's the other thing, is I have no numbers to base this on. That was the biggest part of this ordinance, was the recycling and the numbers. The fee was something that was suggested actually by the commission.
We don't have any way of knowing the total tonnage of solid waste, but this is designed to promote recycling, to promote education, to help offset the expenses of the post-closure of the current landfill, and those are things that we currently, that the current solid waste fees are going to. So this is in addition to those fees that we've left.
Well, dedicated revenue. The infrastructure maintenance will be collected by the county, page 11. Under this article, shall be dedicated to the following: maintenance of the county streets, corridors, alleys, thoroughfares, and transportation routes, administration of contract compliance between customers and companies where service is received as provided in this article, and collection of litter and trash within the county. I do believe there's another.
Would this go like into an itemized fund? Is that your belief, or just go into a general fund?
That would be up to the commission.
Well,
well, this would be a dedicated revenue.
So we'd have line items.
Right. I'm, at this point, I would anticipate it going into a special revenue fund.
There's actually right two or three divisions of this fund as part of the obvious. One and a half against everybody, 1% if they offer recycling, and 0.5 if they take a legal. So are those three separate funds or one fund?
You know, this equates to my bill's $15 a month.
How much are you going to be? By encouraging people to recycle versus some kind of a scale difference. Without mandating recycling, without having some kind of fee or something to change, there is no incentive left for recycling unless you mandate it.
Are you pleased with it? Do you think it's a good?
I think it's a good start. I don't expect it to be a huge revenue generator, but that wasn't, I don't think, the purpose. The intent was to get something in place to build if we need, or this may get in place and be, you know, completely give me the numbers I need and everything looks great.
How they encourage recycling?
To answer the commissioner's question, I think it's still one source. It's several different measurements of one source. So I anticipate it being one restricted revenue. Whether they're paying 1.5 or 3
Yes, and it's the same source.
Just different measurements and the same purpose.
And I will say, because I don't want to mislead you, there's two references to where the fees will go in here. And the one that we were just looking at only lists three. And there should have actually been a fourth. And the other area in here, I'm sure there is a fourth. And it actually allocates a fourth place for the fund to go to. Keep Forsyth County Beautiful does the litter anyway. But there is two separate sections that have that same funding, and that one is just like that.
Never, ever.
I have one question though. Because these are different purposes in that series on page 11, as the county attorney, it uses the word and.
Yep.
Does that mean we have to come up with some way of dividing it among these three purposes, or do we have discretion? Does the board have discretion when they appropriate the dollars for a particular purpose?
They have discretion.
Okay, so it can go for off to one purpose or the other.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Or would tell me, I don't know if you want to change the wording or not.
And slash or.
And let's see.
And here we pirate the same for some high dollar city down below the metro.
Running well down there, I might add.
Do we want to make that change, Council?
We can, it's fine. And you can't hurt with and or.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I could, I would make that as part of the motion. Group this as presented with the change in section 5, 4-6-11-75 on page 11,
yep.
Where it talks about dedicated revenue. This is and or.
Yep.
You make that change and move forward.
Second. And just for clarification, this is to get to the legal hearings?
Yeah, go to public hearings.
Get to public hearings.
Yeah. Legal hearings.
Legal hearings.
Legal.
Legal ads for public hearings.
They must call them legal hearings in Tennessee, or Ottawa or something, wherever it's from.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0. The commissioner event being absent.
Mr. Chairman, I need to apologize to the board, but I need us to revisit items 3 and 4. And I'll tell you why. You all asked me a question during that discussion about the 30-day process, and I believe I gave you an opinion, having pulled up the ethics ordinance, that there was 30 days for the nominating process. And I feel like that if upon further review, and I'm sitting here staring at it and had time to digest the full paragraph, if I feel like I've gotten it wrong, I need to tell you. So let me tell you why I'm saying what I'm saying. The language says that the group of individuals shall have 30 days in which to conduct their appointment process. My problem is, in speaking with Pat, I know we only got one nomination, for instance, with respect to the employees, but that would typically have involved a vote. So if we're supposed to nominate and vote within 30 days, that's the process, then I think it's, to me, that means it's pretty clear that the nomination process is going to be less than 30. Does that make sense? Because there's supposed to be a nomination and a vote all within 30 days, and we bring the results to you. And I apologize that I messed that up when I just.
How long do we think we need for the election now?
This is a time to define that, because you can't have a one-day nominating period and then close it.
I don't disagree with that.
And then 29 days, you know, or somebody's going to.
Absolutely. I think that we need to revisit the ordinance and just put this on hold until we can revise the ordinance.
There's no grounds for revising.
There's grounds.
Not when they've made a recommendation.
It's confusing.
Yes, it is confusing.
They apparently weren't confused by that.
Well, I think they were.
I don't know. They were able to.
And as the governing body.
Well, it took Ken 2 times like that.
And he probably
drank. He not to be confused.
That thing was on a hiatus for how long with that ethics ordinance against them? It's not going to hurt them to take time to get it right. So I would make a motion that we review the ethics ordinance at the next work session. So if we need to clarify, we do so. And I hope it would require public hearings and then go back and have the elections accordingly.
I might like to just interject that all previous nomination processes have followed the same process that we have. Not that it says that the previous ones were right, but it does follow the same exact methodology and interpretation of the ethics ordinance.
I think we had it wrong before, and I think we need to get it right.
Second. All right.
So are we voting again or reconsidering or what?
Well, the motion was to to basically reject the nominations and start the process over again.
I think that we need to rescind those and then make a motion to address the ordinance confusion and get it cleared up before we do it again.
Well, if you want to do that, we need to go ahead and make a motion for reconsideration of the previous items.
Can we move my second?
Does it go to public hearing then, Ken?
We'll get to that. Let's make the motion for reconsideration first.
I'd like to first make a motion, Counselor, if you don't mind, as a separate issue, that we, at the next work session, have you bring back language that's clear, that lays out very clear steps for nominations and elections, notifications, et cetera.
Dates and times.
And that we get that right. I'd like to make that motion first, which I think I can. So that would be my motion.
Well, I'm just going to go ahead and say this then. I am uncomfortable with us. The agenda item is simply the ratification of these two issues. I am sorry. I got it wrong. I did. I mean, it seems to me that it's a 30-day process, not a 30-day nomination window. But what I have heard in the interim is that this is how we've done it for years. And, you know,
yeah, but if we've done it wrong for years, Counselor, with all due respect, I think you're hearing the board say we want to get it right. I think that's what you're hearing down here.
Well, that's fine. I don't know that it's wrong. Is my problem.
It's confusing.
It's confusing. And I'm not prepared to appoint somebody to a board as important as the ethics board, not knowing if we're following the ethics ordinance to set the ethics board. I think that it's difficult for us to assume that we have it right and perhaps face an ethics complaint that we're not following the ethics ordinance.
I have a suggestion. Maybe we just postpone 3 or 4, and then in the interim direct you to bring this to a public hearing. Then we're not voting down.
When do the present individuals leave?
Well, their term would cease June 30th of this year, 2012.
Okay. We have some time.
I think we have some time to get it right. And I think that we need to bring it to the next work session. I've just asked Cindy if you could just have them, if somebody's okay with it, then we'll put it on the next work session to review those portions of the ethics ordinance. I asked Ken to have something prepared for that work session that is very, very clear on what that is.
Well, are we reconsidering this or not?
Do we need to rescind our motion on 3 and 4 first?
We don't. We can. I'm not comfortable, Counselor, if you just want me to say it out loud, rescinding these until we have the other stuff corrected. Because on top of having concerns about the process being followed, I hate to say it publicly, I have some concerns about the individual that's been appointed because he's involved with potential litigation on a very issue that I don't think he should be appointed.
And I'm not trying to get into that. I really am not. I made a call earlier that it was a 30-day nominating process. I'm telling you, I don't read it that way now. And I'm apologizing for the fact that I gave you bad advice.
So I think we need to set this issue get straight, and then we'll postpone this.
But I'm also telling you that my HR director is saying this is the process we followed historically. This is the process that's in the ordinance. If you all want to revisit it, I will revisit it. I'm uncomfortable, though, if we're not going to ratify what the process has produced.
I don't think we can ratify something if we believe it's in conflict with the ordinance or not clear. How do you expect the board to ratify something when we don't know? Just because it's been done before doesn't mean that it's been done correctly.
I'd like to make a motion to reconsider items 3 and 4.
I think we had a motion and how are we doing the other issue? We've gone on the next work session.
Right now it is, yes. Okay. You've given direction for me to bring back language to the next work session on the ordinance.
Is that an outstanding motion?
No.
No, that wasn't a motion at all. That was just direction.
I just want to make sure there wasn't a motion.
All right,
So a motion to reconsider both items?
Yes.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. I believe that passes.
And board members, again, I apologize.
I'd like to make a motion that we postpone item number 3 and 4 until we get the ethics ordinance resolved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Aye. And that passes 3-1 with Commissioner Levent being absent. All right. Sign ordinance. Number 8.
Ken, sorry about that. I know it's confusing sometimes.
Sign ordinance. Got two items. Finding day and night from the sign ordinance. Two parts of this item. They're both things that came up at past board sessions. First is purchase. And we talked about this at the last work session, and I tried to pick up what I could from that discussion. And I've included in your agenda, folks, this one page table. This is a snapshot of today's sign ordinance with two edits in it. Again, what we heard about were churches struggling with, at least one church struggling, looking for direct illumination, which direct illumination is internal lighting. They're currently allowed indirect illumination, which is the floodlight, the external floodlight. The proposal in front of you, what it would do is it would take churches in residential or agricultural zoning districts, and it would not give them all the ability that a business in a commercial zoning has, but it lands them somewhere in between what they are allowed to do today and what a commercial business could do. I think, again, with the input I heard at the last work session, I felt like this would be a starting point for discussion. I'm not sure it captures everything.
I think it's a great start for discussion.
Here, thank you.
I appreciate the hard work. Yeah, we do have kind of a gray area there, so I want to see if we can bring this forward to a public hearing. That's where we go, right? We're going to change the ordinance.
Next step would be to public hearings.
All right, and just kind of flush some of these people out to talk about it and get going. So wait,
we want to be in we can't specify churches.
I want the beginning to be his sheet.
Sheet, I hear. Look at the changes.
This would apply to more than churches, that's correct.
Yeah.
Clubs, lodges,
bars, discos.
Anything that there are a handful of odd uses that are non-residential, permitted in residential zoning, cemeteries, clubs, lodges.
It would
apply to those as well, that's correct.
But also, if we can somehow work it in there, Brian, how do we, we talked about the type of road.
Right. Talk about major roads.
Yeah, because I wouldn't really want to see it on where's, where's one of our engineering guys? What do we call the neighborhood roads?
That's good.
That it would only be on major.
Collector. Internal roads.
Arterial or collector?
Major arterial. Minor arterial or collectors.
Well, I think that's something that can be brought up.
I'd like to have it included, though, as part of it, because I don't want to see subdivisions and things like that happening in those little small ones.
That's fine.
That's okay.
So my motion is for you to bring forward that language that you have drafted on your table to public hearing and address the type of roadways that will affect or be included in major arterials,
minor
collectors,
minor arterials,
collectors. So we have a member of the planning commission here, so I'm going to, you guys have worked on this a little bit, right? Are you comfortable with that much? Do you think? Is there anything you'd like to do there?
No.
We just need to get it rolling.
Yes.
Because.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levin being absent.
There is a actual agenda item. We did have two parts of it. The first was discussed back in January at a work session. The board made a motion. We were talking about a new trend we were seeing with miniature wooden billboards.
With all due respect, do you want to move on this portion sometimes here?
This is his. This is his, baby.
There's no rush. There's no rush on our part.
I would rather him be here to address it. What's that? Do you overlay?
No, freestanding. No,
we're stripping overlays out.
Are we?
Okay.
Yeah, two of those big freestanding signs.
Yeah, all kinds of heights and. Well, this is the way. Can we just put this on the next work session, please?
We'll do that.
We need a vote.
To postpone? Date certain, yes, sir.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levin being absent. Item number 9, I think, is a power reclamation facility.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. You want me right there?
We hear you a lot better down here.
Okay, shout. Well, I know Tim's going to have input as well.
He talks
well. That's a whole idea. So. Anyway, the commissioners had asked us to bring this back before you discuss it. If you remember back on the April 10th work session, we requested moving forward with phases 3 and 4 of the Fowler wastewater treatment plant expansion. And at that time, the board, we had sent a letter to AECOM asking for some additional information in regards to perhaps changing the type of membranes. And at that work session, the board also asked them to be looking at changing phases 1 and 2 as well. That's phases 3 and 4 that we requested. We did get information back. AECOM did respond to us. We got information on May 16th and on May 18th. And the information that they did provide did not address our questions that we had asked in our letter. And I have a copy of our letter. If you'd like to see that, what we can send out. They did not provide any justification in changing our membrane type, nor in changing out phases 1 and 2 at this time. Our staff recommendation still remains the same, to stay with our current contract, meaning moving forward with changing out phases 3 and 4 with the GP Xenon membrane type, and that AECOM replace phases 1 and 2 membranes as required for the contract.
They provided a lot of information here. I'd like to ask.
Let me ask you a question first. We did a combination discussing 9 and 10. It looks like we do 9 before 10. Just want to confuse that. We approved yours, didn't
we? Well, I think it says it probably need to be
combined.
They did be combined, I think. And I'd like to hear from you, Dave, about why. What they missed, why they missed it, or whatever.
Can we combine the two of them, Kim?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if you wish to combine 9 and 10, you can do that, but for the record, I would prefer that being the way of the motion, to combine the items.
Before we do, can anybody think of a reason not to do combining? No, okay.
Make a motion we combine the discussion. I'll make a discussion of 9 and 10 together.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levin being absent.
What are the questions? We had 10 questions. Which ones did they miss?
Well, they touched on a few, but they did not answer off most of them. And we asked for it to be provided in a certain format, which they did not follow whatsoever. Commissioner Bell, it was really straightforward. They told us they have this information. Why they didn't provide it to us, I can't answer that question.
This is staying with the senior.
She's recommending we send it to
you. That's right. That's Stafford.
And the real reason, big reason for that, a lot of it's timing. One thing I want to point out is since last fall, when we started looking at changing membranes, we stopped replacing the old ones. The old ones are worn out, and it's time to replace them. We were in the middle of a change-out process, and obviously, if we're going to keep changing them out, every one that replaced is less money to go toward a change-out, so we stopped. Since the first of the year, the plant's really been struggling, limping along, and we have diverted flow, I think, already to a cost of about $70,000 of our cost because the membranes can't always treat the flow. At least one week out of each month. We were asked to divert flow for the last month and a half. It's almost been continuous. So as we go forward, we need to get this resolved, because that's what we realized in January. We were out of time to make changes. There's no way we could get this in and approved. So we're losing, for the last month and a half, about $1,500 a day in diverting flow. Starting August, the middle of August, we'll have the Lower Big Creek pump station back. That allowed about $1,200 a day in savings over sending the flow to Fulton County. So each in the changeout process after August, we're going to have to start adding money to our 2012 budget, because we can't save that. So there's accruing costs. We're bleeding is the best way to put it, and we need to get this resolved and move on with whichever process, and not keep extending it. So it, you know, to boil it down, you know, on top of the daily, and I don't know what we believe, the existing membranes can be replaced faster than any changeout, and we can at least get them in sooner than a changeout process. We do not know that. We'd have to ask Xenon. But we're being asked to contribute, and in this last proposal, the cost went up, and the number of membranes we were going to get went down. So we're being asked to contribute about $500,000 to do the change out that we don't have to spend.
Jim, let me ask you a question. I'm looking at page 4 or 5,
on which
letter provided by AECOM on May 16th.
Yes.
Item A at the bottom, to the county.
Right.
That our capacity will increase by about $1 million MGD.
Yep. These are good questions.
The plant operator is telling us that they will expect to be able to treat another one MGD. Is
with
that
what?
Correct?
With
the Kubota membrane.
And what we asked for was to see what you can do with the other. We believe you can do the same thing with the others, and with the C's and the D's. And that's what we needed to see to show you.
So how does Kubota filters compare? I mean, do you think the Xenon could be changed quicker and easier than going changing all four?
And do you think they can get us the 1 million gallons a day extra?
That's what we've been told. We haven't asked them, so we've heard one side, and we haven't gone out for a comparison proposal.
Here didn't invite them. Why don't we postpone this and have them come in? Because the million gallons a day is worth about $1.9 million to the county. That's 1.9. I want just a minute to the county, to the taxpayers. The changeover is going to save another $1 million later on.
Well, that's not.
It's going to restore, as I said, the value, bringing it up totally. I mean, we've asked them to provide some things, and I find it hard to understand. When we're talking about a 1.9, a 1 million, and a 2 million, that's $4.9 million in benefit to the owners of that system, which is the taxpayers of this county.
May I just add something here?
Because we didn't get it in a format that we asked for?
No, sir, that's not, and I'd like to go back to that, because you alluded to that. If these numbers are justifiable and easily shown, I don't know why it could not be shown to us in the format we asked, that we see who the Kubota and the GE Xenon with the questions that we ask, so the staff and technical could really look at that and see if these numbers are correct and justifiable. And that is why we asked for it that way, and that is why we really wanted it. And we've been asking for this information for quite some time.
Well,
and so I guess I don't want to get hung up by a format, but I want to get a hung up on
numbers
that
show.
We need to see the numbers.
Numbers
and
are
see
real,
the justification.
Words are fuzzy.
If Xenon is, actually, this is a good indicator of the type of service they've given us in the past. Aren't they here to defend their product? Or
AECOM
is our contractor. AECOM is the one that is supposed to be handling our contract with them.
Why don't we let AECOM speak? Okay. Go ahead. You seem to get caught up in these.
Address B
was confusing. That was a big thing. Yet sounds good on that second page, $1 million. So we asked, you know, inevitable membrane conversion. And that was based on an assumption from AECOM that GE is going to stop supporting this membrane type, which they've got thousands of these out there. And so there's absolutely no, they said they're going to continue to support those. They've got thousands of them worldwide, and they have no intention of stopping support. So to put this statement in a letter by AECOM based on an assumption that they believe because we just absolutely, none of us could understand where they're coming up with $1 million cost in 5 years. It's just terribly misleading.
Was that from there?
And so, yes.
I thought they were here.
Oh, they were. Okay. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, let me get the timeline straight here.
Who are you?
I'm Nick Cooper with AECOM. I'm project manager and have been since the inception of the project. Just to get the time.
The project being Fowler plant, is what you're saying?
Yeah, the Fowler plant, right, the reclamation system. Just to make sure we understand the timeline, the letter that we were asked to prepare was based on our original recommendation of the Coke Puron methods, where we're just looking at a phase 3-4 addition. So when we found that what was on the table was a discussion of putting all of the thinning, all the membranes, that made that discussion move. We could still provide you information on the Coke Puron, but the date of that was overridden by the request of the board. So we had it ready to give, and then when the board said they wanted to know what it would be for a complete changeout, that changed the hierarchy or the requirement. There's been no letter asking us to compare the Kubota with the xenon membranes. So our original statement back in March is that we were just going to add the Coke membranes because that was most economical. It fit in well with the existing system. So what we have now is a response to your request at the board meeting of April 24th.
That's when they were instructed to go with Kubota and
AECOM. Right, and that's what we're responding to today, is the request that we had in front of the board, which obviated the other request. I mean, we're no longer talking about the Coke Puron membranes, which is what the response had to be for. So, just want to get that straight. We never responded to that because we said, and we responded in the email, that was no longer on the table until we knew that this wasn't going to be considered. So, we have no problem comparing the Coke membranes with the xenon, but that's not a factor right now. So, what we do have is an offer that we're making to the county, and what it provides is a way of modernizing the system to the current. We had actually three different options we looked at. We had the GE Xenon 500D, which had a proposal. We had the Coke Puron, which had a similar proposal to do that. And then we had the Kubota membranes, which are a flat plate membrane. It's a different type of configuration. It's the same type that you have at the James Creek plant. And this was the recommendation of the board for us to proceed with one or the other of these process or vendors. We were directed at April 24th to proceed with the vendor for Kubota. So that was the basis of what we've done. That's the basis of the letter. And we also sent a supplemental letter which talked about the specific advantages of Kubota for this project. And that's what we did, and we followed that direction. And that's what we have in front of you. So what we're offering essentially is to take monies that you currently have planned for the expansion, which is about $940,000, and apply that towards a modernization of the whole plant. We offer to do it with any of the three vendors, and what was selected at the board was one of the vendors. So we have that cost. There's a cost that we're contributing, which is the cost of replacing membranes that we would have to incur. If we replace the old version of membranes with a new copy of the old membranes, that's money that we're expending that we won't have available later to apply towards this conversion. So
one of the vendors, which vendor?
Well, the vendor that was selected at the last meeting was the Ovivo Kubota vendor, and we were asked to process that, come up with that. Now, we said we really needed to have a direction from the board.
Just the clear, on April 24th, the board voted to proceed with phases 1, 2, 3, and 4 with Kubota,
right,
and it passed unanimously.
I think you gave him direction to compare. I know what you said.
They were given, they were told to proceed.
We had to use one vendor. We don't want to get three.
No, that's just what you talked about. And it says there's a motion by me and a second by me to proceed with phases 1, 2, and 3 with Kubota, and for AECOM to bring back full details and full specifications to present it at the next work session.
Yeah. Right.
So that's why they didn't bring that together, I guess.
Yeah, that's why I said.
Do we have that information, though, that we've requested, the full details and specifications?
Well, at this time, it doesn't matter.
But only to compare a different membrane system. It was never to compare the Florida system. So if we were directed to do that, we would have.
They did bring that to.
We have a letter and we have the email that we sent.
Yeah, they did bring it to Water Sewer Committee. Yeah. And they even had the graphs and drawings showing the different basins. I remember that.
Well, but that, yeah, the specific items that Ms. Cucarola asked us to provide, we were prepared to provide. If the decision was made to reject the whole concept of conversion, once the conversion was the current plan on the table, it was a moot point to discuss the pure on numbers. Yeah, so when we were directed to do that, we still have that letter. And if you want, we can certainly propose the pure on membranes, but that's no longer part of the comparison.
It's not really the first time we've asked for numbers instead of words, and we just haven't. We haven't seen the numbers yet to justify the recommending to the county to do it. And, you know, if you didn't understand that we wanted numbers from those questions on that day, and I see where it was going to be pure on, but I think it asked to bring back to answer the question so we could make a recommendation.
They were told to go vote and bring back justification. They did provide those, Tim. I've seen them somewhere.
That was previous at earlier meetings that they brought different things to us without the numbers that we'd ever asked for.
No, they brought it.
This has changed. They're doing less now than they were then. And the price has gone up than that proposal. So it changes all the time, and we just.
Well, the original proposal we gave you was in December, and here we are 5 months later. We now have essentially two turnkey projects. We're going to be putting in the membranes. It's going to totally managed by the Ovivo folks. They take full responsibility. And then the influent pump station is going to be done by our other vendor. So that's an additional item that's not part of this. All right, and like I said, we would be able to give you that for any of the three vendors. We weren't willing to do independent negotiations with each.
Have we compared, like Tim said, have we compared dollars to dollars yet?
Can I address one issue, if you don't mind?
Go ahead.
In August, we were invited to contact AECOM and provide a proposal. I represent AECOM.
Who are you, sir?
John Kiefer. Thank you. We met with the staff. We, at their direction, at Tim's direction, John Marshall's direction, we contacted AECOM to provide a proposal for the replacement of membranes at Fowler. And I'd just like it to be known that our proposal was $800,000 lower than the Xenon, the existing vendor's proposal. One thing that seems to be missed is that Xenon is now given the opportunity to go back and lower their price to match ours. Had we not gotten involved in that process, would Forsyth County be looking at an $800,000 additional cost to stay with its existing vendor?
For a company that provided no service when we needed it.
That's correct.
Well,
that issue has been questioned. I wanted to make sure it was brought up.
I need to say, I agree with John that we asked them, and we did. We're open to this consideration, but it's not Forsyth County that would have the $800,000. It's AECOM that's on the hook for all of that cost. And there's history behind the relationship between GE and AECOM in a previous contract. So the statement, again, the letter talks about it being a county savings. It's really AECOM savings that did get recognized. But they're responsible for replacing those membranes. So
is it in their contract? Place?
Yes. We have pre-purchased, and that brings up another issue that Don will probably talk about, is if we modify, is the fact that we've purchased a product and now we want to change to a different product. Is that
okay? But Xenon said they don't produce the product that we pre-purchased. They could specially make it, but it costs more.
They do
make it, but it costs more because they're now making the D's over the C's.
Those membranes went up 60% in 1 year.
Yeah. So, you know,
we appealed to the county, and the county said, if you can find comparable membranes that are, you know, that was back in August, and we spent the effort all the way through December to come up with those concepts. We lost 5 months in that process. And, you know, we felt there was good faith in both sides that, you know, if we can come up with something and show you that it's comparable, that you would be accepted of it. So it's only now that we're sensing that.
Well, it's the numbers. When we had numbers about the expansion, and when we cross-reference back to what we hear on the other products, they can do the same thing for possibly less money. And we hear that the new Xenon membranes can provide extra expansion. So there hasn't been an independent engineer evaluation of the right numbers.
Who told you that?
The GE people.
Has he provided you anything to document that, or is he just...
They'd give us, and that's what we asked for in the rates, was the permeability rates, and we, that's what we expected them to answer back.
Where's the info from? I mean, if you've got it, why not share it with them?
Is it appropriate to ask, that in the interest of time, I mean appropriate, I'm not going to ask you, in the interest of time that we postpone this, we've got more...
It seems like there's information coming from all angles.
We're running out of time to change buildings.
We have 1 hour left before planning commission.
Every day, every minute, it's costing...
I'm with you if you want to keep it going.
No, I'm with you, no. I'd like to get the information.
This is costing us $1,500 a day.
We have to look at it, this costs us money in the long run.
Well, I understand that, but it seems that there's information now that we don't have to make a decision. How are we expected to make decisions if we don't have all the information?
We think ECOM has that because their first proposal...
But Tim, if we have it, why haven't you provided it to us?
It needs to go to them, we just got emails.
I've never seen anything further, I mean, I've seen one proposal...
How are we supposed to make decisions when we don't have full information? If you've got information, we need to have it.
We haven't been allowed to really submit.
You could certainly give it to me and say, look what ECOM's doing. They said they can meet it. And if you've got that, I need to know it. We can't make decisions without information.
Or we postpone.
We need to.
Next work session. Get some figures, need some figures.
We've got to get this done.
And we'd like to also discuss the costing, it says like an allocation, it's not an allocation.
Okay.
Here's what I'm going to... Exactly numbers.
One more time.
Not saying it's a trick, yes.
Let's go back. Would you please provide the chart that we need?
Dollar figures.
To meet the, whatever this line is. Okay? Whatever they ask for, I know that's not what you instructed last time. Let's go ahead and do the...
All three are just dated April 5th.
Just one.
The letter dated April 5th, you answered the 10 questions. Let's look at the cost. Let's have Voda come in, let's have Xenon come in, and if Huron wants to participate, they need to come in and be here to answer these questions so that we can make a decision. Because I hear different things from different people. Now, I've got a letter from you, a PE who's in this business, that tells me that you support the Komodo truck.
I say it has value to the county.
And so, you know, now we're going back and saying, well, there's information that's out there that you don't have, that I don't have, and I'm expected to make a decision on it. And this is a big problem.
We were directed to look at one vendor, and that's how we did it. We did not want to do three independent negotiations. This is Lee Grant.
My name is Lee Grant. I'm a vice president with AECOM. And I happened to attend the meeting 6 weeks ago when we were directed to look at the illegal project. And so that's what we did. And this isn't just an engineering exercise. This is a construction exercise. We were asked to put together a price that's design, construction, hard bids. We've had to go to our vendors, get hard numbers. And that's why Nick was asking that question, because this was a design build exercise and effort and not just an engineering exercise. I understand the questions that were asked, but those are estimates. When you get into that point, you're looking at estimates. Any vendor can tell you anything, but you've got terms and conditions and risk allocation and all those items that need to go into that, and to ask us to do that for three separate, because they all end up having little nuances, is really putting a burden on us that I don't believe is appropriate.
And I understand that, sir, but even your letters that you just sent to us, they do not say that these are hard costs, they say they're estimated costs.
These are the costs that make up our offer.
Right, but they do say they're estimated costs.
But we're making an offer. I mean, the point is it's an offer. This is not
I understand that. And the reason that it says estimated is, and I can clarify it if you need to say, is because of the allocation that comes from the county. Okay, there's a number that's in there as a placeholder for that particular portion, because that's a number that came from the old contract that gets moved forward. So that part is an allocation at this part based on what we believe that number to be, and that's why we use the word estimate.
But it's on that allocation, but on these membranes that you're proposing, we don't really know the cost of those. We knew the cost of the GE Xenon, and that's how we came up with that rationale. We had the $2,002. We knew what the costs that they were at that time. And so that's why we had it based upon the CPIU to bring that cost up to current dollars.
But that's not just the Xena. That was our responsibility to deliver a membrane.
Equal
the county added a specific requirement to have that as xenon. Mm-hmm. And now xenon comes back and says in the original pricing that it's going to be $800,000 more. That's when the other vendors started to come in, and the pricing from xenon came down. So all of these things end up into the mix, and it's not one of those clear cut type of scenarios. I certainly understand that. And so to go back and provide estimates for these other pieces and parts, that's not even fair to our partners now
that
with Ovivo, because we have hard numbers that are out in the internet public.
And I understand, but I'm going to go back to these questions, and I apologize, Commissioner Mills, I know you don't want to hear it.
It's not that I don't want to hear it, it's just that on April 24th, the board gave a different direction. And forgive me, Donna, but the board has given direction.
I understand, sir. But I also heard that, and I know you gave direction to go to the Kubota, but I also heard you to answer the 10 questions when you were talking about it. Please answer these questions.
On the 24th?
Yes, sir.
No,
on the 10th. I apologize, the 10th. Okay. I'm sorry, on the 10th. And these questions that I'm talking about, a lot of them, sir, are not cost indicative. They're not cost driven. They are about the capabilities of the membrane. That's the majority of these questions, sir. So I just want you to realize that.
I really thought we were going to compare to both of them to see what kind of true cost savings we want to have.
We specifically said
that's my aspect.
We have to also recognize that we're not here on a daily basis. There's a huge disconnect between our staff and AECOM. Huge disconnect. That shouldn't exist, but it does. I don't know whose fault it is, but it's not fair to either. We've got a huge water treatment plant that is just sitting there while we have this disconnect. And I'm concerned about it more than anything.
We're losing money,
and we seem to have an attitude that if they lose money, we don't care. As a matter of fact, if we can make them lose money, we're happier with that. And I've heard that statement, and I'm not happy with that statement. So I have a hard time accepting the recommendations. Now, I hate to sit here in public and say that, because I don't like to throw our staff under the bus in public, but I have heard those, and I don't think
how hard it is to get numbers. That's all I'm saying.
We would have to get
contractors in to price it up as if it was another system.
And that's adding additional cost on us.
Yeah, and that cost is.
What do you think it costs to do that? Just
you mean to do the estimates?
To get all this put together.
Well, I mean, I don't even, I'm just hearing it the first time. I guess the point is I have a complete estimate that covers all the elements involved.
There's something more than these 10 questions going on here. I don't know what it is.
And I don't have a problem with answering those 10 questions if it's going to be on the Kubota. I can do that today.
Right.
But that wasn't, we were told that was no longer. This was just for phase 3-4. That's all that was intended.
So, but again, they would have to be based on, I'm thinking out that if you don't mind.
I don't know why we continue to do this when we continue to have documentation over and over and over and over, that it saves money, that it increases capacity.
To be honest, the good faith on our side was we assumed that the board was directing us to look at one system. If it was cost effective, make the change, you would. If not, then you don't. And to have us do another and another option, I think at some point the board's going to have to make that directive. We said at the time, this is your asset. You have to make that choice. If you chose Xenon and that was the option, we would price that up and tell you what that
was. And I have to remind you that all of us here, it was a unanimous vote to do this. It wasn't my vote or your vote.
I thought this got back to figures, hard figures. I agree.
We're giving a firm, we're saying this is our offer, how much we would need you to contribute. We're donating to this cause, $450,000, plus the cost of cleaning that we've had to do in all these months that we've lost, probably about 8 months that we've been cleaning. That's all donated. All my time is donated. So for us to say, here, this is the exact
number. We also have to consider this screen.
But what's the cost plus for Xenon? Are we going to contribute another $450,000 for Xenon?
No. I think that's part.
Yes,
of
you would.
Important part. Yes, we would.
They said no.
If you elect to make the conversion, which is what Xenon was talking about, that's what Xenon was proposing.
Xenon goes to five. Xenon is
that true?
Five
brand new system.
We can stay with the current
membranes.
Why would we want to stay with old technology?
They're just different size. They're not a lot. They're not a lot different.
Then why'd they quit making them?
They have
the 500 C's. They were here, Tim, and they said that we've quit making them, but we'll make them in limited quantities that people are going to
use. The D's are cheaper, and so most anybody who orders them is going with the
cheaper. And why are they cheaper? Because they're making more of the D's and they're making limited C's. Because they're transferring everybody over to D's from C's. They're cheaper because they make more, because they quit making the C's.
But they may have had a contract with Xenon for the price of these phases 3 and 4, I don't know.
Is it hard to put the numbers together? Has it been that hard to put numbers?
Well, we wouldn't think so.
We don't have access to the numbers. They're coming through AECOM, who are dealing with the membrane manufacturers.
We did this in December, and we gave you an offer in February and March, and we showed the comparative numbers of the three options.
But, I mean, they're buying seeds now for the replacements. I mean, we've gotten some numbers from Xenon. We have to buy them at the Manor plant. That's what the Manor plant has, so we can get a price to what it would take to stay just like we've got and put C's and not go to the D style. We can get a price from them directly to us.
Do you want to get the D's as well?
C's and D's, that's, I don't know how
to get the price.
D's that require modifications. We can look at the change out in a few years, and that's what we would recommend.
I'm sorry?
Price of Kubota's. Price that out.
It's already been done. Yeah, all that work.
It's already. That's it already. Right.
Commissioner, that are clear. You're asking us to get a price to stay with C's for phase 3 and 4.
Because we already got C's in 1 and 2.
Yes, sir. And that will then necessitate AECOM going back and fulfilling their contractual obligation to make the membranes in 1 and 2, phases 1 and 2, fully operational. Mm-hmm. So that's included at their cost.
That, does that involve cleaning them or
replacement
at their cost?
As they wear out.
Do we want to put 500 C's in the third and fourth basins? Do we want to put old technology in?
We're getting prices first. We'll get prices.
Do we even want to consider it? Do we want to waste the time to put old technology in the new basins? That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah, we studied that. And obviously, to start with, we like the D's. They allowed a little more space later on for expansion. But you can do that conversion to Xenon in 8 years if you want to go to D's, and they're already working on a Model E. So by the time we really need the capacity, all of these membranes will be being replaced again. We don't have anywhere to put the flow now. So
one thing
C's are taller, and they pack them together, and they do have a little higher permeate capability, so they can squeeze more additional cassettes in the same tank. And that's their advantage.
And we want to see the additional capacity, because I have a great concern that we've oversold the capacity. We know we have. We've got the spreadsheets to show it. And this million will allow us to do one of two things. Either sell capacity, $1.9 million worth. More than that, it's $1,019 shelf. It's $19 million, right?
Yes.
$19 million worth of capacity.
Well,
I thought 1.9. But a million gallons a day, that's...
A million gallons a day is $19 million. But we don't have anywhere to put it, so...
But that's okay. We've set ourselves to meet the obligations where we've already oversold.
And right. Well,
so I want to see that we get... I want to see what capacity we get from these other ones.
If somebody want to make a motion on this, we've got about 20 minutes.
You might postpone. Just postpone. I make a motion we postpone it to January.
I think we ought to call a water and sewer committee and get to the bottom of it, because I'm sick of coming in here and getting conflicting information.
Okay, you can do that. But let's postpone January 12th. Maybe you can have one. June 12th, I'm sorry.
Second. You have a motion?
The direction from the board for staff as of today is what? Postpone and do what? I want to make sure everybody's clear.
Compare against the official numbers from 3 and 4, and then finish it up 1 and 2, back to type C's. And then I guess price type D's out, and then get a price on Kubota filters and what the capacity of the plant will increase to.
Isn't part of that exercise then for AECOM to justify to the county deviating from the current contract?
Yes. Okay. These are justifications.
Deviating from the contract?
No, they're
is there justification?
I don't know if it's a deviation or if it's a, let's be fair, it's not a, I know we've been talking about this capital already. Yeah, it's an option that we can either use the 500 Cs or the Ds, or the Puronco, or the Xenon. I mean, or the Kubota.
There's a cost associated with that. Well, there is. What we would be looking for is a justification to spend above what we currently spend on the contract.
That justification comes from if we're going to spend an additional $13,000 a month on this, where do we get a return on that investment? Because we can't spend money without a return on investment.
I mean, all of the options we looked at had much more capacity than the current option. Okay, we have to start with that.
Well, we need to put that all in paper. Put some figures down. If you'd have a water source.
This has already come through the water source committee, and it came up with a recommendation to use the bonus. The board's recommending the bonus, and for some reason, we keep getting new information every time we meet. So, whatever you guys want to do.
You understand? Can you do that for us?
Are we postponing this?
Yes. June 20th.
We have a motion and a second to postpone. If there's no further discussion, please hold on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to bring something up.
Yes.
We need to go ahead and set up a meeting for tomorrow afternoon or Thursday morning. I would, anticipating, I think what the mayor had said in their city council meeting this morning, he was waiting on our offer. Obviously, there's a possibility he may counter our counter, his counter,
all right,
our
counter.
I was going to suggest Thursday morning.
Well. We want to set up a tentative time for tomorrow and then a tentative time for Thursday?
Well, I think if we give them tomorrow, should we review it? Unless he wants to meet tomorrow.
Well, my only concern is let's say he gets it. Let's say he has it now and he's already made changes and hands it. Then we've wasted Wednesday.
Sure, that's fine. All right, we'll see you tomorrow.
I can't meet tomorrow. I mean, we could, y'all don't need me here, but. That would be an issue.
Well, let's make it Thursday then.
Let's make it in the morning so that Thursday if morning. Something goes over, maybe we can meet then again Thursday afternoon or Friday morning.
All right, 8 a.m.
Who won't? Of course. I know you won't.
Yeah.
But, I think we're pretty close. 8:39, Counselor, what time do you get up?
I think we say 1:08 a day.
Okay. You can't be here, or you can be here Thursday sometime?
Okay. What time?
Anytime.
How about this guy? 9:00? 9:30? What, 8:30?
How about mine?
You need that work.
9:00? You do that?
Yep. Thursday?
Who's going to advertise?
Well, you'll handle that, Chairman.
You don't mind.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask a question. Do we need an executive session, Ken, and how much time do we need?
Yeah, we got it.
We did in an executive session. It's up to the board, and I can watch.
Because how long do you think?
30
many items?
33. Well, four.
How many more of these work sessions are crucial?
These items?
We got 15 minutes. What do you need done?
Jen, you got the next two items.
The annexation by the city of Cumming, we need to get to that.
Okay. All right, let's do that one right now. Let's at least do that one so we know we get 16. To that.
Do we need a motion, Kim?
I'd like to make a motion that we take item 16 next.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Benton absent. Annexation request by the city of Cumming. This is the one over by Grove Park?
No, this is Sony MC.
What time are we?
Oh.
4 decades, Sony MC.
You left out, didn't you, Ken? 9:00.
Yeah.
That's lunchtime.
This is on Veterans Memorial Boulevard. Is that what it is?
Yes, sir.
I can call it.
Yeah,
okay. Here's the map.
I'll take care of it.
There's the city, that's the boundary of the city.
and here's what they're requesting to annex. There is contiguity. So the question becomes is what is the prospective land use? They're using the 60% method, which is an appropriate method for annexation.
Basically, you did.
They are, well, it is, and that's why, let me get you, though, the...
Yeah, they already have annexed that already. This is the old side of MC, this is all the new stuff.
Oh, this is approved.
Yeah, this approved by Air Force Systems Bank. This is storage buildings.
All right, the property is currently zoned in county commercial business district and is shown in our future land use map as employment center.
This is the bank.
The city of Cumming intends to zone the property highway business. Planning and development has confirmed the current zoning of the property. The intended zoning will not defer, and the intensity will not change, and nor do they find that the future land use map is substantially different from our existing zoning or our comprehensive land use map. So, my recommendation to you based upon that determination is that we not tender objection to the proposed annexation.
We have a motion and a second. There's no further discussion.
Time sensitive.
Yes. Motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Dent being absent. Are there any other? Are there any things that can be postponed on here? Items.
12 and 13. I mean, there are people here waiting on 12 and 11. I would like to do 11.
12
and 11 is. 11 lets us put money in the bank.
And you might know it, we have to change the tapes. So we, just as we need to hurry up, we need to take a break.
Two minute break.
What do you mean we don't follow all that?
We used to. We've got to muddle through them a little bit. We're not as svelte as we once were. At this end of the day. Not that much.
Huh?
They're ready. So let's, where are we here?
Did you just use the word svelte?
Number 11, I'd like to call the
board back to order. We're talking about item 11, Tim.
Mr. Chairman, this is a standard sewer reservation agreement. This is a one of our favorite green pipe subdivisions that didn't make it to final plat that Ryland Homes has now picked up. It's off Post Road, and they have delivered a check to purchase this sewer capacity, and we recommend you approve this purchase of sewer capacity with Ryland Homes.
So moved. Second. Got a motion and second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye. This is a time sensitive. Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, like sign. There is none. This is for Ryland. We all voted. Do you want to vote yay or nay?
Yay.
Yeah.
Okay, that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levent being absent. Okay. Number 12.
Okay, number 12. In discussing at the water or at the agenda review, we have collected quite a bit of sewer tap fees this year, and we have a refund policy that the board approved a few years ago, and it's dependent upon having cash coming in on the sewer tap side to give those refunds. And so far to date, with the agreement you just approved, which was a little over $300,000, we have collected a little over $1.2 million for the year. By policy, the water and sewer director can issue refunds up to 50% of what we've collected, with the review of the finance department for some other things, looking like we're going to have a positive cash flow for the year, looking like we're going to meet our budget expectations for the year. So we've collected quite a bit of money. What I handed out was the list of people who have been being denied or put back. They were listed in green. And we have one developer that's made a recent request, number 5, Mr. Stringer is here. And what I brought to you was each one of those requests that we have yet to refund. If they made their request in less than 2 years, they were entitled by policy to 95% of their purchase. If it's over 2 years, it's 90% of the purchase price. So on the right side in red, you have the recalculated number. Number 2 there recently platted. Ryland platted 120 lots. And so they've taken part of those, their previous requests off the table. They're actually considering not keeping this. They if they're able to plat the next phase quickly, they'll be losing 10% of this, and they don't know what their repurchase price will be in 2 or 3 years. So they told me to leave them on the list, but they may actually deny the request. The same goes with number 4. That was the motel that was proposed at Georgia 400 and 141 for a while, Mr. Bauer, and he is considering keeping it right now. He said leave him on the list. But the board can choose to go above the 50%. And that's just cash that we've received. David, obviously, they have to review this. I will say all of the conditions, there's conditions to meet each one of these requests. We've reviewed all of the, at least the first 5. Number 5's a little, let me just say it's, it was one of the earlier ones that we went about it in a different way. The policy says if we've expended funds to get sewer to the project that we haven't recovered, then we're not supposed to grant the request. This is one where the county spent $3 million to put infrastructure in, and they were one of the first ones that had to do the reservation to get us to do that. We spread that $3 million cost out over all of the capacity, so not until we sold all of the capacity would we be fully made whole. But I don't really think that should be applied to his request, because we sold $400,000 worth of Hampton capacity because of that line, and because of the profit in the sewer capacity, we have recovered our $3 million, is what I'm trying to say. not specifically on this line, but as the basin as a whole, when you add in the sales on the sewer taps, we have got our money back from what we purchased the capacity from the Hampton plant and what we put in the infrastructure. So we're not in the hole there. So I feel that we have recovered our investment. We had to do that to get these people started. This particular project was one of the first ones that wrote us a check for 25% of it till we ran the line that enabled us to get it going. So I just needed to state
would
that.
Would it make sense at this point to, with the other ones, not exactly what Dave's going to say, but I would like to ask that the board consider refunding number 5. And also, because the other ones are so small, if we can clear up 6 and 7 as well, whatever here.
How about 9, I believe? 9 small.
Yeah, 9. So get those done.
Say we have to go in order.
Well, I don't know. let's stay with number 5 right now. I'd like to ask if we could do that.
You know, what's my number 7?
Let me just stay with number 5 for a minute, Tim. I had always struggled with the notion of the restocking fee, if you will, that the previous board put in place. I just don't believe that. We've had that money sitting in the bank earning interest on it, and I just have a hard time with that part of the policy as well.
Is that 5%?
Yeah, I just don't see. I mean, it's
10%.
10%, right? $100,000. We've had their money in the bank since 2004, earning interest on it. And I think that would satisfy any type of benefit to the authority is the interest that they've earned. So I'd like to ask if we could just refund it in entirety. They also paid the $750,000 for the traffic signal at Hubbardtown at 400. And when we were in a bind, they sold us back capacities, and they didn't know if they were going to need it. So they've been a good player and a good actor. I'd like to ask them to refund.
But would this set precedence for all of them?
Yeah, but then we get, once again, we got the water and sewer department subsidizing other departments.
Yeah. Well, it's not really subsidizing. They sold us capacity back because we needed it, and we asked them to. Because we were oversold or have some trouble at the time. So they agreed to sell us capacity. They didn't know if they were going to need it or not. If they came to us, they sold it back to us to help. Yeah. In addition, they did pay.
Okay, now that's different.
Yeah.
That's different.
So they were a good actor, if you will.
Okay.
They didn't ask us to do anything. They didn't say, well, I'll sell to you for $22 a gallon. So I just think that we ought to kind of reciprocate and not require that.
How much we got to give the refund?
By policy around
2 million.
That's if you just get to 5. If you want to stick with 50% for the year, do you want to go above that?
If we say 50% for the year,
it would only be 640,000.
Of the total 2 million that could qualify.
I mean, do you need a motion for that, or can we just? If we give back $1 million, that's going to go over 50%, isn't it?
Yeah,
that's what needs board approval.
I would make a motion that we authorize a refund to Georgia Industrial Investments in the amount of $1,155,000, which equates to 100% of their money. I recognize it goes over the 50%, and I'd like to make that time sensitive.
Sir.
And there's nothing in the policy that prohibits that, as long as it's board approved.
It's got to be board approved.
No.
I don't know.
I don't know about the 5 or 10% part.
I'm not sure that's 5 or 10%.
But the board is about to approve the dollar.
I will amend the motion, if you don't mind, if it's allowable, that they'll refund it. If not, you
got to
do
the other. You want to check the resolution.
Okay. All right, we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0.
Yes,
the commission will grant the unanimous.
Oh, all of them. I mean, they're...
Just wait the next month.
Yeah, they're gonna...
Well, it seems they weren't on the agenda, in all fairness, trying to stay. Why don't we just put them a month out, at the next work session?
Yeah, let's do the next work session.
And you can gather, you can make sure there's been no money expended and all those kind of things as well.
We discussed it again.
Yeah, I think we've got some more money coming in, hopefully later this year also, and...
Well, let's look at that, make sure.
But we will probably, it'd be best to address those earlier ones if we can.
Okay, Tim, what does the refundee need to do? Call you, call Tim, call... What do they need to do?
I think, oh, these others?
No, the one that's... What does he need to do? Does he need to...
He'll call you.
Okay.
Get all the...
I just want to make sure he knows.
Are we supposed to wait tonight?
He'll call me. Soon as we hear from Ken on the 90%, 100%, then we'll get that going.
And we're moving to address it again.
Thirteen, fourteen.
Check that too.
Yeah.
No, we did seven, seven.
We would take them in order, the list.
All right, is there a motion to postpone?
Talks here, but it's supposed to be...
Items, 13, 14, 15, 17, 18, and 19.
No, we've already done 18.
Thirteen, 14, 15, 17.
That's it.
To when, to when?
To June 12.
Why don't we do it Thursday morning?
That's needed. No, I've got to sit here along with Nydia.
All right, next work session.
Next work session.
All of those, uh-huh.
Yeah, 13, 14, 15, and 17.
June 12.
We have a motion in the second if the...
Second.
We have a motion in the second if there's no further motion, please. Vote on the motion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign, that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levent being absent.
Just want to update you all, you know, we've got to pull the policy out. And with respect, it does anticipate that the refund request will be reviewed in the order, the chronological order of which the requests are made. So what we might have to do is when we come back the next work session, we may have to take up 1 through 4.
Well, he kind of explained that they were holding something. He mentioned they talked something.
But they did say leave them on the list.
Yes, but they didn't say they wanted the money back right now.
Well, they've made requests. That's why they're on the list.
But he already addressed it, that he went through them, that one of them said leave them on the books for a while, that they might have a use for.
He got a nebulous answer.
Yeah, okay. It was. Maybe we need to... I know we got to address them.
Number two.
Are they listed?
They told me to leave them on the list for the refund, but they
for consideration.
May, before we write them the check, they may change their mind.
Are they listed in chronological?
Yes, they're in order.
Okay. Just want to thank you.
I'm happy with where they are. I would just like to maybe bring it back when we can and maybe address the others in a more detailed way.
We are too.
That's what I'm saying, so yeah, I'm happy with that. Right.
Maybe review the whole list or
prioritize. Is there any other further business to come before this board? If not, the council, do we need executive session?
Yes.
We do.
Okay. Is there a motion to adjourn to executive sessions? For the purpose of litigation, personnel, and land acquisition.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those are in favor signify by saying aye.
Recess.
Or a recess.
Recess.
Yes.
Recess. We're going to have to play dodgeball.
That passes 4-0.
Speaker.
Sitting absent. We are recessed at 6:07.
I'm ready for recess.
And
good secret. You take care.
I hate to be this way, but we're time pressed.
Yeah.
If you're not in executive session, please.